Yes. You got it, boss. Welcome to Southeast Valley Bible Church. We're so glad that you are with us. If this is your first time here, we'd love to get you some more information about our church. And so if you'd like that information, you'll have one of our pastors either will be in the back or at the very front at the very end of the service, and we can get you some more information about our church. I have a few very quick announcements for you. We are still looking for volunteers for nursery and children's church. So if you could reach out to me or Katie, our information is in the bulletin. So if you could let us know, we'd love to get you involved in that or answer any questions you have about that. Our Good Friday service is coming up very quickly. It's going to be April 2nd at 7 p.m. We're very excited about that. Doug is going to be giving that message that evening, and we're excited to hear what he has that the Lord puts on his heart. And also, of course, Resurrection Sunday is the following, and we're going to be doing a fellowship breakfast during Sunday school time, and we'll have more information about that coming out this week. We have summer camp coming up very quickly at Grandview. We have Junior Week from June 28th to July 2nd, and Teen Week from July 5th through the 10th. If you are interested in going to camp, you would want to get signed up sooner than later for sure. And then if there is some reason that you would love to go to camp and you don't feel that you can afford that or that your family can, please talk to us. We want to make sure that your kids can go to camp.
Let me know.
Yes. Perfect. Okay, so, and Blynn, please communicate if your kids are going to be riding with us in the church van up. Please let us know so we can make sure that we have enough seats and that we can get everyone up to camp like we're supposed to. I think that's it for that. And then we're going to have Isaac Glandon's going to come up and share with us a little bit about Grandview. And
good morning. My name is Isaac Glandon, for those of you who don't know me. I've been at camp for about close to 3 years now. I started in 2019 past, financially and through prayers too. It's been awesome. I have a PowerPoint with some pictures, Austin, if you want to start clicking through some of those. Just some pictures about camp itself. It's a beautiful place. They're going to be from last year, so counselors in 2020. These are the staff members that make camp possible. They're all volunteers, specifically 2020. The ones from 2019, I can't find those pictures anywhere. But we get to stay at Grandview year-round, host retreats, and then do college classes. It's a wonderful opportunity, and I get to work with a team of students. Austin, could you possibly go back to the one right after my last cabin? Oh, maybe it's not there. Sorry, keep going. It's a picture of four of us with a bunch of work stuff. So it's during this time in the off season. I'm back for just a week right now. But during this time in the off season, we're preparing for the summer. So we're getting the games ready. We're getting the program side, all of that stuff ready for camp. Me and my friend Peter, which is going to be on the next slide, we're going to be co-program directors this summer, so not counselors per se for the campers. We're going to be running the program side of things, the games, the fun time skit nights, all of that stuff. And then we're also going to be the guys lead counselors. So what that means is that we get to counsel the counselors. All the counselors there, they have a blast with the kids, but it's a really high intensity job. They're with the kids all the time. They have to be with them all the time. Or I should say they get to be with them all the time. It is a wonderful opportunity. So, but me and Peter are going to be the ones that talk to them, to encourage them, pray for them, set examples for them. And so that's part of what we're going to be doing, what we're preparing for right now in the off season. So just one last thing. This is just a little bit of the ministry. If you guys want to talk to me about it later after church or something, just pull me aside. I'll be here basically probably till, you know, they close and lock the doors. So just pull me aside. I'd be happy to talk about it. Like I said, none of the staff here actually get paid. They all are volunteering their entire summers. And we have quite a few staff. Honor Davis is going to be coming back for to be one of the wranglers, working with the horses and taking the kids on trail rides, all sorts of fun stuff like that. So It's a wonderful opportunity. If you are wanting to support me or even to just know more about it, I have home support forms. These have a lot of information on them. I can talk to you about that later. If you want to support me financially and honor as well, you could just write down different names on here. So let me know. But most importantly, I would ask that you support me through prayer, me and the camp and all the other staff members. We're looking forward to a great summer. Normally we have about 7 weeks or six weeks of Arizona camp. We had to add a seventh week because we have so many kids that want to come. And it's awesome. Spots are filling up. So if you want to sign your kids up, please do it soon. And we have all the staff members that we are needing for the summer, which happened really early this time. But it's awesome. People are excited to come. Just be praying that God prepares their hearts. The staff members are going to be the ones serving the campers, and pray that God opens up the campers' hearts. They need to see Christ, and Grandview Camp is a beautiful place for that. So, yeah, that's about it. Thank you again. So, Pastor Joel.
So the way this works is that if you would like to support Isaac or Honor, or any of our young people that want to help for the summer, I think it's $1,500 for the summer. Is that right? So if you want to write a check, $1,500 for one of them, Southeast Valley Bible Church, just put in a little memo section to whom it's going. And then Brother Glandon here, we're very thankful for his ministry and ministry preparation. He's doing two things at the same time. He's coming alongside of that fantastic camp. It's our camp, by the way. We're one of the, like, our church was one of the first churches that ever officially became part of the group that really is behind this camp. And if you haven't gone, you need to go. So talk to me about if you've not been to camp and you'd like to go, let's figure out a time for you to go. If the Lord leads you to give, yes, we're trying to raise $1,500 for the kids during the summer, but this guy here, he's also doing, so it's not just him serving during the summer, he's also doing his Christian university studies while he's at camp. And so he's killing two birds with one stone. Can I say that from the pulpit? I just did. So he's doing two things at once. So honestly, if the Lord leads you to give more than $1,500, like if you want to write a check for $4,000 for our brother, just know that, not only will that cover him for the summer, that's also going to help with his tuition. So that's what I'll say.
Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to Southeast Valley. Please stand together as we read from God's word. John chapter 4, this beautiful encounter of our Lord Jesus, who encounters a down and outer, right? Someone that the world has rejected and despised. And when Jesus meets this precious woman, listen to what he says in John chapter 4, verse 23. The hour is coming and is actually now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking you. The Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And if you're here today, I want to just affirm to you that God is seeking you. God has sought us. He has sought us when we were far and we were down and outer, and he's set his love on us and sent Christ to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. And it's a privilege to be his people, to respond to what God has done by worshiping him. So let's begin our worship service singing this prayer, "Here I Am to Worship."
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God.
We'll continue our worship service with a song of corporate confession, our song of the month, Lord have mercy for what we have done, and then we'll respond by reminding ourselves what God has done, to remind ourselves of our Savior, who right now is at the right hand of God interceding for us. So let's begin by singing, Lord have mercy.
For what we have done and left undone, we fall on your countless mercies. For sins that are known and those unknown, we call on your name so holy. For envy and pride, for closing our eyes, for scorning our very neighbor. In thought, word, and deed, we failed you, our King. How deeply we need a Savior. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy.
hearts that are cold, for seizing control, for scorning our very Maker.
In thought,
word, and deed, we failed you, our King.
How deeply we need
a Savior. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy.
Christ,
have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us.
Amen. Please stand if you're able as we sing Before the Throne of God Above.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free.
Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and with Christ my Savior and my God.
Amen. Please be seated.
The text we'll look at for the Lord's Supper today is, we'll go to the familiar passage of 1 Corinthians, and we'll go to 1 Corinthians 11. We'll look at verses 23 We'll start at verses 23, but I wanted to talk to you about the significance of meals in Scripture. I've always found that to be interesting. Obviously, you don't get to be a guy my size without enjoying meals, and I'm glad to see that reinforced in Scripture. I joke, but they are important. They're important as a family. On this side of raising kids, we have four children. They are all, over 24, 22, over 22 years old, so we have lots of things to look back on. You can't underestimate the significance of meals shared as a family. I think one of the most important things, if you have children under that age, and I would say even if you have children over that age, time spent around a table should be treasured and intentional time. Building relationships happens around food and beverage, coffee and tea. Taking the time to be intentional around moments like that is not only modeled in Scripture and seems to be near and dear to the Lord's heart and patterned all through Scripture, but it should be that way for us as well. So not only are families strengthened, but relationships are strengthened and forged around such things. Potlucks, that was pre-COVID. We don't necessarily do potlucks anymore, but maybe one day again, those will be reinstituted. But the very fabric of family and friends have often been forged around food. So it's no surprise that as we look through Scripture, we see something very similar. We see this beautiful pattern of sharing meals, and we see beautiful pattern of hospitality all through Scripture. Even if we go all the way to the beginning of the Bible, we see an unfortunate pattern where humanity is plunged into sin in the sharing of a meal in an inappropriate way. But then we start to see a healthy pattern. We see things where, like Passover feasts are implemented, and this beautiful thing, very structured feasts to honor and celebrate and remember are taking place. And then we see Christ on the scene. And what does Christ do? We're seeing some of that in Acts. Does he go eat with all the pastors? No, he's going and eating with sinners. Tax collectors, prostitutes. He's going and having meals and fellowship. And it's interesting how many times he's out there eating and doing that around the table. So clearly food and fellowship and that piece of it is significant. Then you would be hard-pressed to find a more beautiful moment than what happens in the upper room when Christ conducts the final Passover. And when he's in the upper room with his disciples, the beautiful heart of our Savior to serve in that moment is one of the unparalleled moments of humility and love in the moment, in the midst of being betrayed and knowing what was what lied ahead of him in the coming hours. Even though it was orchestrated and it was a redemptive, beautiful plan, he knew it lie ahead, but yet his heart was full of love and service. That all of that was happening around that beautiful, that final Passover, facilitated by our Savior. And what do we look forward to? We look forward to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So when we look ahead to glory, there's this feast waiting for us. So look at this pattern from the beginning of creation to the Passover feast, to Jesus coming and enjoying feasts with, when glory takes on flesh, he's enjoying feasts. Then the Passover, is culminated in Christ. And then we're looking forward to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So then we have this time in between. This time in between, we are giving these beautiful ordinances. We're given two primary ordinances in the church: baptism and the Lord's table, or the Lord's Supper. And those are treasures. Those are treasures to the church, and they should be treasures to our souls as believers, both of which are commanded and instituted within the church. And both of which are times of remembrance, renewal, an opportunity of reflection, times for us to still our mind, quiet our heart, take inventory, what's going on within our, you know, in our conscience, in our thought life, in the relationships, and ask if there's anything that that is inconsistent with the nature and character of our Savior. As Doug pointed out so well in Sunday school this morning, inconsistent with the nature and character of God's revealed word. And as believers, we must elevate that above any justification or rationalization or minimizing that we've got going on in our own feeble minds, and lay that on the altar. And these are the kinds of moments that we're able to do that because we love our God, we love our Savior. We make much of his word. And an opportunity like the Lord's Supper is a wonderful time to do exactly that. And in when we look at this text, the word is so clear. Now we know in this body we're not dealing with, you know, the juice is not obviously actual blood, the bread is not actual body. We're not in any way making that claim, but it needs to be said. The qualification to participate in the Lord's table is that you're a believer. You know that Christ is your Savior. Pastor Joel says it's not a closed communion, it's a close communion, that you're within the fellowship of Christ, and that you're a believer. And that's what's required in the text of Scripture. I will read, I'm just going to move through these verses. Verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after the supper, saying, 'This is the cup. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink, it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Therefore, now the piece of this is we don't want to, you know, there are people who try to make the bread or the wine or the juice to into something it's not, but we also don't want to make it less than what it is. You need to make sure that you do take that inventory and you look for unconfessed sin, and you do take a moment of private reflection, private confession, and go to the Lord before you go to the table, and work through that before your Savior, based on what the Lord is doing in your heart, because there are warnings right here in the text. "Therefore, whosoever eats of the bread or drinks of the cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and of the blood of the Lord. But a person must examine himself or herself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and then drink of the cup." So there's a warning in Scripture. So what I would like to do is I would just like to take a few, just 30 seconds, and let's just be quiet in our mind, and let's just give ourselves a time to think in the quietness of the moment, and let's just pray quietly, and then I will close in prayer, and then we will prepare to take the Lord's table. So 30 seconds. Father, we come before you humbled at your beautiful plan of redemption. We marvel at your sacrifice. We marvel at your sovereign, not only knowledge, Lord, not only your wisdom, but at your power and authority over all things. Lord, your ability to weave and control all things for your glory and for our good. Lord, it is your ways are so far beyond our ways. Lord, your ability to see through not only our actions, Lord, but directly into our heart and into our motive. But Lord, even in that intimacy, Lord, you are overwhelming grace and mercy. And Lord, you long for the posture of our heart and mind to be that of humility and obedience and faithfulness. Because Lord, we are finite, we are simple, and Lord, it's the only reasonable posture. And Lord, the only reason we wouldn't is if we're proud and if we're if there's hubris and haughtiness, Lord. And you know those things are, you're opposed to those things, Lord, and you love us too much to not oppose those things. So Lord, we come in these moments especially, Lord, and may the posture of our heart be humility, Lord, and may we freely confess that which is contrary to your nature and your character, Lord. And we want to honor you in this moment. We want to reflect and remember your faithfulness all through Scripture when we see you time and time again be faithful to your people. And Lord, may we remember and reflect on all the ways you've been faithful to this church. And may we reflect and remember all the ways in which you've been faithful to our families. And Lord, may we reflect and remember all the ways in which you've been faithful to us. And Lord, we just come to you in trust and thankfulness and hearts full of gratitude. And I just pray that you would flush out those things that are contrary to you, Lord. And we're just going to give you all the praise and the honor and glory. And we want to be a light in the darkness to make much of your name, not ours. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. So at this time, we will prepare to take the Lord's Supper. And the instructions are pretty basic. We've done it a few times now, so we'll go ahead and get started. We'll have half the room come forward and partake of the element, and half go backwards, and go ahead and begin now. Thank you. Scripture says, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So do this in remembrance of me. His word says, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And it says, when you do this, they went out and sang. And so Jeremy will come and lead us in doing exactly that.
Please stand together if you're able. Please be seated.
If you have your bulletins, please open those up and let's look at the catechism. Catechism,
Catechism. How does God respond to human sin? We'll answer together. All sin is opposed to the righteousness of God and is therefore subject to God's holy condemnation. Yet God in his mercy offers me forgiveness, salvation from sin through Jesus, the only Savior. Amen. If you'd like a sermon outline, just raise your hand and Brother Gary will see your hand. We'll dismiss the children, sixth grade and down. And if you want to turn to 1 Peter, turn your Bibles to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. This morning I'm preaching from my NASB. And look at the size of that thing. God's word is a sword, and it is also a sledgehammer, apparently. And that was a gift from a conference. I think it's made out of elephant leather or something like that. It's just unbelievable. 1 Peter chapter 1, and this morning we'll be reading from the NASB, New American Standard Bible. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who are chosen, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood, may grace and peace be yours in the fullest measure. This morning we continue. Thank you, Pastor Troy, for leading us in the Lord's table. That was very much a blessing to have Brother Troy lead us. I just want to say how much I really appreciate all of our pastors, the pastoral team. Just in the last, within the last month, we've been blessed. We've, in our small group, Brother Stephen often leads. Doug helps. Doug taught this morning in Sunday school. Brother Tom just did Wednesday Word. And also helps in the Sunday school class. And, of course, Pastor Gary preached, and Jesse continues to preach from time to time and help us in a variety of ways. And, of course, my son and associate pastor Jeremy preached here just a few weeks ago, and we're looking forward to Doug leading us for Good Friday. So we are surrounded by just men of God. And all of what's a blessing is all of these men have what it takes to lead their own congregation. And the Lord has placed them all here, and I personally benefit from them. And it is just a blessing sent from heaven that we have these kind, not even including the deacons and other leaders and office staff and helpers and all of you that serve. And so we're just very thankful for all of that. 1 Peter chapter 1, in verses 1 through 2, this morning we try to pick up where we left off last week in introducing 1 Peter, and I was actually thinking it would be possible for us just to do an introduction without also trying to cover verses 1 and verse 2. Honestly, I don't know of another book in the Bible which brings as much heavy-hitting theology in the first two verses of the epistle than what we're looking at right here in 1 Peter. This passage is just simply loaded, and we attempted to begin to introduce this last week, and so I'll try not to repeat myself. I am sure that I will repeat myself from time to time, and so I apologize ahead of time. Notice, right, in a few things that, again, as last week, there were a few things I had you add that were not in the notes. We'll do that again today. As we think about this first letter, this first epistle of Peter to the church there in Asia Minor. And of course, you can see at the end of verse 2, or at the end of verse 1, he lists these different regions: Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. You know, I love the local church. I love what that means. It means that we here together are covenanting together to walk Christ together, to represent Christ together. Actually, one of the themes that one of the in verse in, on page 2 of your notes, we're actually going to look at a whole host of other themes that we're going to see in 1 Peter that we did not even get to last week. So in other words, page 2 in your notes, that was not there in last week's sermon, but we're going to get there. And I've left out a variety of things that don't even show up on page 2. 1 Peter is that jam-packed with delicious theology and helpful revelation from God to his children who are aliens in a hostile environment. And one of the things that it doesn't even show up on page 2 is we're actually going to find out Peter is going to address a lot of one another commands. As we're going to see, not just in the first epistle, but also the second epistle, in these two epistles, these two letters of 1 and 2 Peter, Peter is going to talk about the one another commands. And so as we read verse 1 and we see these different individual locations, most of these locations would have had at least a single church. My guess is that in many of these locations, you probably had multiple house churches, like in Galatia. You probably didn't just have one house church in Galatia. You probably had multiple house churches. You probably had the same in Pontus, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. You probably had, and yet, so on the one hand, this discussion in 1 Peter, this very much ought to have your attention because this is written from Christ to you. But we as a local church, Southeast Valley Bible Church, Gilbert, Arizona, we ought to pay special attention because 1 Peter has some things that we need to hear from us. And then a sister church today, you know, the various sister churches that we love that we pray for often here in our week-to-week church life, 1 Peter has something to say to them. And then get a load of this, and I love this. And frankly, I love what Troy said, reminded all of us, is our position on communion. We don't believe in closed communion, that when we have the Lord's table, that's just for the members of Southeast Valley Bible Church. Why is that? Because as important as our church is, there's a church that's even more important. It's the universal church. It's the body of Christ. Now, on the one hand, my specific calling and gifts are, first of all, and primarily to my family, but second of all, to this congregation. And then I've got a calling to the universal church, and I give that sphere time through my ministry at IBL. But this calling is very, very important. By the way, if you want to, I don't think I camped on this last week. Notice, look at verse 1. Peter, an apostle. You might underline apostle, circle apostle. It's interesting. Peter could have said, Peter, a disciple. The idea of a disciple is one who follows Christ. All of us are disciples. I think there's a wrong connotation that, well, a disciple is a Christian who's really, really, really serious. Like, I'm willing to be a Christian, but I'm not willing to be a disciple. That dichotomy is not found anywhere in the Scriptures. If you're a believer in Christ, if you're a follower of Christ, if you're a Christian, you are a disciple. God has called all of us to discipleship. But those disciples that we often think disciples, God called them one more step, which is an apostle. And so when you see apostle, this is and this is not in your notes, you might want to write this down. Really, the idea of apostle is a person who is sent. The English linguistics of the word apostle literally means an emissary. And so here, Peter is saying as he's writing this letter, hey, I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. Peter is saying, I was sent by Jesus to represent Jesus and to speak in the place of Jesus. Now, Peter, the Roman church will say that Peter sits in the place of Christ as pontiff, the first pope. Our scriptures don't teach that. Okay. But he was an apostle, just as there were other apostles. You had the 12 apostles, then you had the 70 apostles, and then you had other apostles, right? You had Paul, and you had Barnabas, and you had Silas, and who we'll see at the end of 1 Peter chapter 5 is mentioned. And so what was an apostle's job? An apostle was sent to speak and to represent Christ. So we have to remember, as we're reading the words of 1 Peter, we're not just reading the words of Peter. As we come to Scripture, as we read God's Word, we have to remember God's Word was written by men, but it was authored by God. And so as an apostle, when Jesus was speaking, as Jesus was communicating, he's representing the very Word of Christ, which is the very Word of God. So when pastors and teachers accurately and prayerfully and humbly preach and teach the voice and the Scriptures written from the apostles and the prophets of God's Word, when we read the apostles and the prophets, please listen to this. This will help you not to check out when you come to church. So when you hear, when Pastor Joel opens up God's Word, when Pastor Troy, Pastor Gary, as we open up God's Word, as we're accurately handling God's Word, you're not just hearing the voice of Joel, and you're not just hearing the voice of Peter, and you're not just hearing the voice of Jesus, you're hearing the voice of the Father. You're hearing God's Word spoken. Now that's going to be very important to these believers that are in Asia, because they're under persecution. And so one of the reasons why Peter writes is to encourage them in the midst of hardship. It's interesting, when we're hearing God's Word, we're hearing the authoritative voice of Christ. By the way, if you're God's child, that matters to you. You might write down John 10:27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. John 10:27. It's interesting. John 10:27. I might just encourage you to look at that whole paragraph, like John 10:25 all the way to verse 29. I think that's going to give you perspective on who my sheep are. How do we become God's sheep to begin with? Notice again in 1 Peter, I think we made mention of this, but let me just make a little bit more of it today. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens. Okay, aliens. We're not talking about little green guys, right? So aliens, what are we talking about? So aliens, these would be visiting foreigners and resident aliens. Hold your finger here in 1 Peter 1. Go over to 1 Peter chapter 2. Look at verse 11. Here we have these same words used again. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. So here Peter is referring to these elect pilgrims, these born-again believers, and we talked about this last week, the meaning of diaspora. This is a church which has been scattered. These are God's children, many of them coming right out of pagan Gentile roots, others saved out of Judaism, and they are spread throughout Asia. And so here, Peter is writing to them as visiting foreigners and resident aliens. So what does that remind us? It reminds us that, look, this is not our home. So a big part of what Peter is doing is he's trying to get our attention that we should not be captured by two extremes as it relates to the world. Let me encourage you to write this. This also is not in your notes. So add this to your notes if you would. There are two extremes that Peter is going to help us. Number one, the extreme of being captured by the world. A worldly church like Laodicea. A worldly church like Corinth. Right. By the way, Laodicea and Corinth, a significant portion of them were truly born-again people. Okay, so it is possible as individual believers, it's possible for us as a church, Southeast Valley Bible Church, it is possible for pockets of brethren and believers to capitulate to the world. Peter is going to remind us, hey, You are visiting foreigners and you are resident aliens. That is to say, you're living in one country, but you're from another country. Don't get cozy here. This is not your home. This reminds us that as Christians, all of us are very much out of place. We're out of place. They don't share our values. Let me give you three C's here. We have a different commander, we have a different constitution, and we have different convictions. Peter is going to explode all three of those, right? He's going to expand all three of those. Number one, we have a different commander. Now, it's true. We pledge allegiance to a flag of the United States, but as much as we pray for a president and as much as we ought to follow governors and as much as we submit to leaders that Christ has placed in positions of leadership, Romans 13, they are not our ultimate. As a matter of fact, in Peter's going to explain that even further as we get into 1 Peter chapter 2, that even when it's difficult to do so, we will follow the emperor, Nero then. We will follow human leaders, but as we will follow human leaders because that's an extension of our loyalty, not to them, but to our ultimate Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're willing even to suffer. And through our commitment of doing good, it will silence the wicked and foolish men, who I think is a reference to twisted government. We have a different commander. We have a different constitution. We have different convictions. Let's, if you would, jump over to bottom of page one in your notes. So more introduction to details concerning 1 Peter that we did not cover last week. Number one, what we just said. Number one, Peter describes the recipients of this epistle as visiting foreigners and resident aliens. This seems to be some kind of a metaphor of the Christian life, not unlike what we saw in Pilgrim's Progress. Page two, top of page two. Number two, these same terms show up in the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible in the days of Jesus called the Septuagint. Various Old Testament passages speaking of God's people Israel use the same term here and there in describing Israel as foreign and alien. He uses the word diaspora. This will emphasize the fact that believers in Jesus in Asia are found in little groups here and there. Lenski says they are often a small and scattered minority surrounded by a great pagan majority. That's the emphasis Peter is writing to, and he's just reminding them, hey, yeah, if all you're focused on is human resources, you're outgunned. If all you're looking at is the size of their military and you know the volume of their wicked music and what's popular versus not popular? Of course, they look greater. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I love the little passage in 2 Kings chapter 6, right? Father, open his eyes that he may see. And what did Elisha's servant see? Wow, the invading Syrian was invaded by the army of God. The host of God. Number three, notice on page two, number three, in the immediate verses previous to 2:11, Peter uses even more descriptions that come from the Old Testament. Now, this is significant. So some descriptions that we see used of Israel is also used of the church, a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. This means while there are discontinuities between the church and Israel, there are continuities between church and Israel. And so the believers that Peter is speaking to include Gentiles. Number four, it's interesting to note that that three of the regions mentioned in 1 Peter chapter 1, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, are mentioned along other regions in Acts 2, 9 through 11. It is extremely likely that many Jewish converts who came to Christ at Pentecost through the human agency of Peter's preaching took the gospel with them back to the northern parts of Asia and beyond. It is also clear, based on 1 Peter 1:12, let's all look at verse 1:12. Notice verse 1:12, it was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you in these things which now have been announced to you through those who have preached the gospel. So Peter is saying other faithful servants of Jehovah, of Christ, have preached you the gospel. This is probably 20, this is at least 20 years, more years, separating Peter from Pentecost. So a lot of gospel ministry has taken place, right? And so last sentence on number 4 on page 2. It's also clear that many who Peter is writing came to Christ by the ministry of others. Number 5, notice another slice of Peter's purpose is not merely trusting God in hardship, but understanding God has given grace, is giving grace, and we are to stand firm in that grace. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 12. I didn't write this next to number 5. You might want to write down, if you would, 1 Peter 1, 6. 1 Peter 1, 6, next to number 5. Notice 1, 6. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. In the margin of your notes, you actually could write, you will be distressed by various trials. That's the sense of the grammar. It's like it's unavoidable, unless your physical death came right after your spiritual birth. Like, can you imagine, like, the thief on the cross? Like, he didn't have to suffer much after he came to faith, right? This day, today, you don't even have to wait till tomorrow. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. How sweet that was. I mean, can you imagine him? I mean, how shot full of guilt he was. I mean, listen, when you're living your life apart from Christ, you are bearing an unbelievable burden of pain. Your mind and your conscience, the more you get to know God, the more your mind and conscience screams in agony. What a relief. What a blessed relief to be not only forgiven, but your conscience clean forever. Sign me up. Talk about having heaven now. I'll take it. I mean, oh, is it going to be great to walk on streets of gold? Yeah. Honestly, I think most of us are just going to be happy to be there. Honestly, most of us look at ourselves in the mirror and say, you're going to forgive me? You're going to give me grace? I get to be your child? A lot of us, and this is not, oh, how righteous I am. Honestly, when we read passages like the disciples that are arguing over who's going to be highest in the kingdom of God, really? What is that? That's to help us feel better about our own problems. Just when you think, oh, I am so pitiful that there's no way that I can truly be, God includes all that, just to let you know you're not the only one that has hit the pity part of the thermostat of what it looks like to be pitiful. And aren't you grateful that God cares? He pitieth his children. Amen. Well, honestly, those of us that we're really clear on our own pathologies of sin. We're very clear on our own guilt. We're very clear on our own failures. Honestly, the clearer we are, the easier it is to be humble. So Peter's going to help us with all of that. All of that's tied to various trials. By the way, it's interesting. If you look at 1:6 as he goes on, look at 1:6. Why do we get these trials? Some of you are asking that question. Joel, why do I have to handle these trials? Look at verse 7. So that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor of the revelation of Jesus Christ. That means when Christ shows up, the testing and the trial and the difficulties that we've gone through, You are a prize to Jesus Christ. And you also, by the way, you're also an effective witness to those that are watching. Instead of you leaving Christ when the ease of Christianity leaves you, you stay with Christ, you demonstrate the genuineness of your faith. And by the way, you also melt out of the genuineness of your faith the pockets of our faith that are not genuine. The pockets of our faith that are filled with the old man and the flesh and stuff that needs to be burned out like dross. God does that. Number 7, the instrument of salvation between God the Father, the Spirit, and the Son is a kind of a saving mercy empowered. Whoops, E, sorry, dear. Empowered. Tony didn't spell check this one this week, so that's my fault. So empowered, not I'm powered, empowered, E-M, yeah. So empowered by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from or over the death of Christ, 1 Peter 1:3. The believer shares in the hope of salvation through the instrument of hope. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead is the foundation of our hope for our resurrection of our death. We are alive in Christ. We died with Christ. We're buried with Christ. We'll rise with Christ. Number 8, for Peter, the central application of salvation for God's children is a powerful reality for him. Jesus substituted himself in his death in suffering for the sins of others. Peter is going to camp on the substitutional atonement of Christ. That doctrine has come under attack. Pastor Jeremy talked about that maybe a month ago. 1 Peter 2, look at 1 Peter 2, 21 through 25. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you. By the way, this is Peter's way of saying, yeah, of course you're going to suffer, but you suffer, but Jesus also suffered. Jesus suffered, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps. Peter's going to build a city on this idea of suffering. By the way, earlier when we talked about the two extremes of the world, I think I just gave you number one. The first extreme is captured by the world, right? The second extreme, I just had mentioned this in the beginning of the introduction, we talked about two extremes to watch out for. One is to capitulate to the world. The second extreme is being cloistered and secluded as we're persecuted, right? Peter knows that's a temptation. So guess what Peter's going to say? Peter's going to say, okay, remember that you're representative aliens of Christ and his kingdom here. You're emissaries of God's work. And so while you live here, you should not look like them, but you need to be around them and you need to serve them at the same time. So there's two extremes with the world. One is we blend in with the world. The other one is we isolate ourselves, we go Amish. Okay? Yeah. We go Amish. We out-Amish the Amish. Years ago, I had a gentleman, and not all homeschoolers are this way, but it was a homeschooling family, and they were sweet people, and the mother especially loved the Lord, and I think the father was something, I think he had drifted into Pharisaistic thinking, and I remember him once bragging to me, you know, that my family, my children, they actually know nobody that doesn't believe in God or knows God. I said, congratulations, you have failed. You have failed. How can salt and light be salt and light if salt and light never gets a chance to act like salt and light? I have an earned doctorate. That was good. How can salt and light, right? Well, what's the point of salt unless it is amongst things that need to be salted, which means they're not salty? What's the point of letting your light shine if you actually never shine your light with people that are amongst the dark or in the dark? Number nine in your notes, number nine, page two. Peter touches on a variety of suffering themes. There is no doubt one theme that the church in America needs to listen to closely is, I've already mentioned this, but I'll mention it again, just in case some of you haven't been ticked off with me yet. I'll try to offend everybody here. 1 Peter 2, 13 through 17. Peter explains Christians must be willing to suffer while they submit to human government that will at times be wrongly harsh with the Christian community. Some Christians today would rather burn down Washington, D.C. rather than submitting to a godless government. But Christians in Rome did not burn Rome. Nero did. So those of you that are part of Christian political subgroups, you're going to burn down the city. Congratulations, you're acting like Nero. You're not acting like Christ. You're offended? Leave offended. That's from God, not from me. I didn't say it. I didn't write it. God did. And Peter wrote it down, and he's an apostle. You don't argue with me. This is apostolic truth. Some of you need to grow up and start thinking biblically instead of thinking politically. 1 Peter 1:15 is especially powerful. The implication is that while being misunderstood and even mistreated by government, it is God's will that Christians would still do good as they are and silence ignorant and foolish men. In the context of 1 Peter, it probably is that Peter is reminding Christians to honor the Roman government as Rome builds centers of colonization in Asia, modern-day Turkey. Participate as often as you can in Roman life without violating your God. This is similar to what Israel heard from Jeremiah in exile. Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you in exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you have welfare. This means the notion of radical separation from Christians out of civic and civil life is not consistent with Peter. It meant that God is telling his mouthpieces and his servants, listen, yeah, your ultimate authority is God, and you worship Jehovah, and you serve Christ, but if you happen to be promoted to the second position of leadership in the Egyptian Empire, you give Egypt your best. You work hard. Make life easier for Pharaoh. I'll plague him with dreams. But you serve him. You take care of him, I'll take care of him. Daniel. Nehemiah. The list goes, I mean, you just think of all these individuals in the Old Testament who were serving wicked Assyrian, Babylonian kings, and yet, I mean, Daniel and his three friends, right? Daniel, I think he outlasted three regimes, right? They keep dying, Daniel keeps living. He keeps serving them. He keeps getting promoted. So Peter's going to talk to us about avoiding the two extremes of, you know, on the one hand, being like the world, on the other hand, being this Amish thing where I have absolutely, okay. Page three, we're going to wrap this up. We'll continue next week. We talked about pilgrims scattered. Notice page four in your notes. Number two, greetings to the elect. Let me just give you one more thought about election, and then notice page five, if you will. Notice page five. Election does what? Well, election brings us to election. By the way, as you look at 1 Peter 2, notice the way he concludes this section. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ, to be sprinkled with his blood. What do we have? Election is tied to all three members of the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. So letter C, election to sanctification. Peter connects the Trinity together with your faith. God the Father chose us. Spirit of God sanctifies us. And then letter D, election is demonstrated by the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus. And notice, and we're not going to read it as we kind of ran out of time. But Exodus 24, I hope that you read it this week. If you did not, I hope you go home and read it. Exodus 24, verse 1 through 8, bottom of page 5. The Holy Spirit set apart the believer in sanctification. The process begins prior to conversion. As the Spirit convicts and brings the individual to repentance and faith, it is the Holy Spirit that grows the believer into the image of Jesus by the blood of Jesus. The language is a new covenant. The allusion harkens back to Exodus 24, when Moses read the law and God's people confirmed that they would follow the law. After these offerings were given, and then blood was sprinkled on the altar, and then it was sprinkled on the people. Here, Peter makes a powerful analogy that the blood of Jesus in the context of the new covenant has been sprinkled on the hearts of those who have placed their faith in Jesus. One thought about election and then conclusion, and then we'll close. Turn, if you will, over to John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Here's what I know. I know that not everybody, we probably in here, my guess is we probably have two or three different ideas on how election, how God's sovereignty, how God's work of election and man's responsibility. We probably have two or three different ideas on how election, the sovereignty of God, and the responsibility of man come together. I want everybody's attention. I'm fine with that. Okay? Good people, good men of God, have come to different ideas on how election and how the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man come together in salvation. It's okay. You don't have to think like me. I didn't used to think like me. And so we're all going to grow at different speeds, and it's really, it's okay. So here's what I would say. If you say, well, Joel, I'm trying to think about the doctrine of election, and I'm just, okay, fine. So some of us are getting hung up on the first part of John 6:37. All that the Father gives me will come to me. Okay, so I've shared to you what I really believe as we look at this passage, we looked at some of the other passages. Say, well, I'm not really sure about that. Let's trust God with the first part of this verse. Somehow, God does election, and it's consistent with himself. And so we can trust that whatever God does is going to be consistent with himself. Let's move on to the next phrase. Notice the next phrase. And the one who comes to me, I will certainly not cast out. So here's what I would say. If you're not sure about election, let's just trust God with the first part. Look at the second part of the verse. Come to God. Just come to Jesus. Come to Christ. Come to him in submission and asking his forgiveness and believing he is who he is. Can you just do that? Are you willing to just come to Christ? If you're willing to come to Christ, you are elect. And if you're not sure exactly how that first part works, fine. You know what? I am really good allowing you to just simply trust in God with the first part of that verse and saying, I'm not entirely sure, Pastor Joel, I see it exactly the way you do. Fine. You don't have to. I didn't write the Bible. I'm not God. Okay, so if you see it a different way, notice the rest of the verse. You come to me, come to Christ, and I will never drive you away. Isn't that good? Okay, now, unless you get cocky, he includes verse 44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. My defense rests. Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for 1 Peter. I pray that you would help us as we move on in the weeks to come from verse 3 on. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Please stand together. As we sing about our great God and Savior.
Skill to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand finds one who is my Savior. I take him at his word indeed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, he's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, he's always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my solace from this day.
Please fellowship together.